of the greatness of you. So I'll sing of your love, and I'll sing of your mercy, and I'll tell the whole world of the greatness of you.
Well, bless the Lord, O my soul, and let us together bless his holy name. It is so wonderful, as usual, to be in your company. Of course, I'm Bishop Hewlin A. Hannah, and I appreciate you. I thank God for you, and I thank God for the meaning and the purpose that you've given to this program by your participation. Many of you have fed back into us. Some of you are sharing the materials, and others are doing some wonderful things with it. And I thank God for you, and I bless the Lord for you today. Now, we want to talk today about this topic, don't walk out on God. Don't walk out on God. And, you know, God is a wonderful God. He blesses us, and he does so much for us. Unfortunately, there are those among us, perhaps even some in the viewing audience, who, for whatever the reason or reasons may be, just choose to walk out on God. We hear about husbands walking out on wives, wives walking out on husbands, and abandoning family and things like that. But can you walk out on God? Some people actually do. And so let's just take a look and see what God is saying to us in today's sermon. To say that God has done great things for his people will be an understatement. We cannot begin to fully appreciate how much he has done for us or what he has kept us from during the course of even one day, let alone a lifetime. In response to his benevolence to us, God asks a simple thing of us, and that is that we choose his Son Jesus Christ as our Savior. And while many can testify to the manifold blessings that come from God, there remains those who will not stop long enough to acknowledge that had it not been for the Lord on their side, they would be in deep trouble even to this very day. The sad part about this is that there are those who claim to serve God and who can tell of his graciousness, yet they've chosen to go after the blessings and ignore the one who provides the blessings in the first place. God does not bless us for us to turn around and walk out on him. He did not bring us from a place of lowly beginning only to have us turn our back on him in desertion. You would recall the story of the flood in the Old Testament. Noah and his family were saved from the devastating floods because they obeyed God. Those on the outside who refused to take refuge in the ark of safety died a tragic death. The survivors of the flood had something to be grateful for. When they walked out of the ark in safety and they looked around, it was not lost on them that something horrific had happened. It was also not lost on them that had it not been for God saving them and protecting them on the ship, on the boat, they too would have lost their lives. Something like this should have given them occasion to serve, worship, and obey God for the rest of their lives. Sadly, even if it happened in the beginning, something went wrong to the extent that the same persons that God had spared from the floods now found themselves walking out on him. In Genesis chapter 11, verses 1 to 5, here's what the scripture says. And I want you to pay attention as we read this passage. Very familiar passage, but we're kind of reminding you of this today. And the whole earth was of one language. God gave them one language. And of one speech, God gave them that also. And it came to pass, as they journeyed from the east, that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. Listen to this now. And they said one to another, go to, let us make brick and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone, and slime had they for mortar. And they said, keep your emphasis on they said, And they said, go to, let us build a city and a tower whose top may reach unto heaven, whose top may reach unto heaven, and let us make us a name. Pay careful attention to these words. Lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. If you forgot anything, or if you forget anything, I've just read that little clause right there. Listen to it again. Lest we be scattered abroad the earth, or upon the face of the whole earth. Keep that in your mind, because that we're going to come back to that towards the end of this sermon. As you read this, we can surmise that their initial reaction may have been noble, given the circumstances that they had only been recently spared from the floods that killed scores of their loved ones and friends. However, as the narrative unfolds, we see them not only building for the present, but alas, they had a grander plan. It was a plan of dangerous proportions. This plan, emphasis, this plan involved them seeking to elevate their affairs to a place where they simply did not need God, or so they thought. Their decision to build a city with the additions of a tower reaching up into the heavens and establishing themselves a name and developing a sense of national pride was more than God was prepared to accept. Listen to it now. This is a sad commentary, because the same God that they were about to walk out on was the same God who delivered them in the first instance. They knew where God brought them from. They knew what God allowed them to experience when the water was so high and they could not find a place for the boat to be anchored. They knew all of these things. They knew invariably that when they came off that ship, it was only by the grace of God that their lives were spared. Many times, we allow our ability to plan and project into the future to interfere with what should ordinarily be our natural dependence on God. We see it all the time. Little men flying in the face of a big God. Weak men attempting to move on their own with no regard for God and no regard for what God has done for them. They forget that it was God who took them through the perils of the time. They forget that had it not been for the mercies of God and our gracious Father, they would still be languishing in the pits of failure and shame. They forget. My friends, we must not follow this trend that is far too common in many communities, and we must not allow this, their legacy, to become our lot. Men may build tall buildings with impressive names and architecture, but it is God who builds character and godliness. Men may razzle-dazzle others with their ingenuity, but it is God who gives us substance. Come back to God and come back down to earth. I want to say that again. Come back to God and come back down to earth. You are too high. You're too high. From the height you now sit, you are a prime target for God to bring you down in humility and humiliation. Come back down to earth. For the survivors of the floods, it was not long before God, in his just judgment, decided to show them what happens when we walk out on him. Listen as I read Genesis 11, 5 through 9. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men build. God knows exactly what is happening. come down. Do not walk out on God. Listen, and the Lord said, this is verse 6, I'm sorry. And the Lord said, behold, the people is one, and they all have one language. We heard this before. And this they begin to do, and now nothing will be restrained from them, which they have imagined to do. In other words, the potential of the mind to do and to do and to do and to improve its own self is tremendous. God is saying this. But God is not saying this as a compliment. God is saying this as to say, these people need to be reined in. And so here's what God says now. He says, go to, let us go down, and there confound their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them. You remember that piece I read earlier? And I said they wanted to be preserved in a geographical location. They wanted a name because they did not want to be scattered abroad the earth. Listen to this compelling verse. So the Lord scattered them abroad from thence upon the face of all the earth. And they left off to build the city. In other words, the work ceased. Listen now. Therefore, the name of that place, that city is called Babel, or Babel, as someone would say. In other words, it's confusion. Because the Lord did there confound the language of all the earth, and from thence did the Lord scatter them abroad upon the face of all the earth. Think about it. We cannot view, or we cannot win at life or anything else if we do not have God at the center of our lives. He is the one that will guide us into a life of victory and success. We do not have to go against God, and we definitely cannot afford to have God to go against us. The world, this world, is mean, and things are not getting any better anytime soon in this world. Therefore, those of us who know God must not allow ourselves to be lulled into a feeling of pride and try to make it on our own. This world will eat you right up. If you know God, stay with God. If you do not know God, get to know God. Because at the pace of this world, if you don't have him, you will be diminished and you'll be completely destroyed in this world. There is no place, no safe place outside of a relationship with God. Think about it. Therefore, do not allow yourselves to be lulled into this feeling of pride, and I can handle this by myself. Everything that we are and ever hope to become will happen if and when God allows it to happen. You don't call the shots. God allows things to happen. He allows one to rise, and he allows another to fall. God is at the epicenter of everything about man. He is our true source. We can ill afford to pay attention to those who are attempting to tell us that we can do this on our own. It is arrogant to behave as if you do not need God. You are standing on a false premise if you feel as if you can make it without God. One sickness will change the trajectory of your life. One scandal will destroy your character. One set of displacement or dislocation by an act of nature will wipe your wealth right out. We cannot afford to walk out on God. It cannot and it will not happen that we will succeed without God. God will not allow anyone, including you and me, to usurp his authority in the earth. The temptation to walk out on God should drive us on our face in complete surrender to Him. There are no success stories out there that a person is better off without God. Can I say it again? There are no success stories anywhere in the world that a person is better off without God. And at the same time, there are no formulae that can tell you and me how to make it without God. We see people running at breakneck speed, trying to tame the world, but their efforts will not succeed. You cannot conquer the world. You can't even conquer your own animalistic desires outside of God. We need Him. Man was born to serve the Lord. It's as simple as that. We are at our best when we are doing those things which are pleasing in His sight. I call on you to remember where you came from and where you could have been. I call on you to remember when you had no name. I call on you to remember who it was that brought you out and made you someone. And I call on nations, and I'm a Bahamian, so in particular, I call on the Commonwealth of the Bahamas to remember where we came from as a people. Or we may be a thriving metropolis now, but do not forget where you came from. Do not dislocate God. Do not diss God, Commonwealth of the Bahamas. To our leaders, watch out. Watch out. Do not walk out on God. I call on you to remember, it was Him who gave us substance and gave us purpose. I call on you not to lose your head and everything else while in the process of trying to run away from God. To those who are old and not serving God, it is about time you make better use of your life and resources and serve the Lord. To the young and the youthful, you are not too young to make up your minds to serve God in the strength of your youth. Young people, serve God. Oh, it is horrific when we read the stories, when we see the sight or the scenes of these murders, when we hear the language and the vitriol coming, spewing out of the mouth of young people. You are not too young to serve the Lord. You can be good examples serving God. Do not walk out on God. You will not conquer the world. You will not conquer the world. You may win scrimmages here and there, but ultimately you will have to face the reality that this world is bigger, badder than you. When you, what you met here in this world, if God does not return before you die, you will leave it right here. Do not walk out on God. Let's think about this. Think about this. God has done so much for us. A songwriter says He woke you up this morning. He started you on your way. He gave you the employment that you have, the income that you earn. They all came from God. What is He asking of us? He's asking us simply to serve Him, to serve Him in spirit and in truth. He's asking for us to be consistent in all that we do. You may have good reasons to be doubtful of religious people. You may have good reasons to be skeptical of persons who stand and who hold the Bible, persons who stand in the pulpit. You may have plausible reasons, but you cannot give God any excuses. Do not walk out on Him. It is sad when we hear stories of husbands and wives, when a wife says, when we were poor, we lived together, we loved each other. When we couldn't barely pay our bills, or when we could barely pay our bills, we loved each other. When we went out by the beach and we enjoyed a simple chicken snack or a sandwich, we had romance, we had intimacy. But now, because my spouse is moving up, because my spouse has greater leverage, now I notice that my spouse has no more interest in me. That's heartbreaking. My spouse walked out on me. When he had no national exams, when he had not even an associate degree, he was always home in the evenings. God has helped him now. He has matriculated through life, and he's a big man. She's a big woman, and she's going places. Have no more interest in me. That is heart-wrenching. But what is even more heartbreaking is when we do the same thing to God. When we flaunt the blessings of God. When we in arrogance turn our faces against God. And when we say, when our actions typify that I am my own man and I am my own woman. This was the problem with the survivors of the flood. They got this feeling that we can build a city. We've been through experiences before. We know what it takes to overcome in the future. And they planned, and they planned to the extent that they planned God out. If you design God out of your future, you are going to have a problematic future. If you look at your future, and if you feel as if God is a humbug, you are going to regret it. You may have all of life's comfort. You may even ridicule this preacher. How dare you, Bishop Hanna, speak to me like this? I'm a religious person. I go to church. I do what is expected of me. I follow a tradition. I'm a good person. How dare you say such things to me? I am but a representative. I am but an oracle of God. I am but a spokesperson of God. And I am telling you that in this book, in God's holy writ, there are no success stories for those who walk away from God. And perhaps I am reminding you of a time in your life when you served God. I'm reminding you of a time in your life when you dared not leave your house unless you prayed. I'm reminding you perhaps of a time on a Sunday when you went nowhere else but church. Nowadays, you are busy. Nowadays, you are encumbered by so many things. Nowadays, I don't have no time for that. I don't have no time for them. Who is them? Who is them? God, who has done so much for you. When was the last time you just sat down and said, Lord, I thank you for your faithfulness. I thank you for the blessings on me. I thank you that I'm not in Thursday's paper. I thank you that they're not talking about me on the radio as a person who was murdered. I thank you that when I went to bed last night, my family was in bed with me. When I got up this morning, I checked on them and they were okay. I thank you that when I looked out of my front door, my neighborhood was intact and things were going well. I thank you. When was the last time you did that? This preacher is not about attacking. This preacher is not about anger and frustration. This preacher is about consciously understanding that God is one day going to call us into account for what we did with his word. And this speaker is imploring you as we get set to pray. This preacher is imploring you not to walk out on God. You can't have it both ways. Can't live like the devil and then be sanctimonious. It is all about him. It's all in or all out. He must be Lord of all or not at all. He must sit in the driver's seat of your life. It's time to pray. Precious Father, in the name of Jesus Christ today, Lord, we come in the seriousness of this moment. We sense, Lord, that there is someone, Lord, who knew you intimately. Someone, Lord, who promulgated your testimonies and the goodness of God. Someone who joyfully served you, but Lord, today, because of their own success story, because of their wealth, because of their affluence, Lord, they have banished you. They don't want to be bothered by you. They have walked out on you. But Father, we pray that even now that the Holy Spirit will arrest their conscience and through the Spirit and the ministry of conviction, but bring them to a common sense place where they recognize that they need you. Yes, they may have everything, or they may think they have everything, but without you, Lord, they are bereft. Without you, they are like a ship without a sail. Help them, Lord, to come back to you. And those who are wrestling with the temptation to leave you, O God. I pray that even as they view this sermon, that they would take a second look and they would hold to God's unchanging hand. I thank you now. I bless you. And I pray for the unsaved that they would come to see your Son, Jesus Christ, as the only Savior for mankind. Bless wherever this ministry is shared. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen and amen. God bless you. I love you. I appreciate you. And I hope and pray that today this message stirred a consciousness and awareness in your own reality, and that you will stay with God. The consequences of doing otherwise are dire. I'm Bishop Hugh Lenhana. I love you. God bless you, and I will see you the next time. Jesus.